My name is Katie Pribyl. I'm the Director of Communications for the General Aviation Manufacturers Association. For some of you who may not be familiar with GAMA, we represent 76 worldwide manufacturers of fixed-wing airplanes, rotorcraft, engines, and avionics. So we're based in Washington, D.C., and we also have an office in Brussels, Belgium, and we're looking at China. So you wonder where the market's going and probably where the world general aviation is going. It's east. Today, we're fortunate to have two experts in media and public relations with us, and the best thing I can do to serve you is get out of their way, but just want to offer up a few things to get you thinking, as if we need to after the last panel, but a few things to think about public relations and media. A couple questions I want you to ask. Does your local media and the trade press in your space know about you, especially local press? Do you know how to break a story? I think a lot of times our flight schools are doing really great things that they may not realize are great stories, or that the local press would definitely come out, or the trade press would definitely come out and cover. A lot of you are doing AeroCamp, Learn to Fly Days, maybe Young Eagles programs. Perhaps you contribute to the Veterans Airlift Command by doing flights or contributing in some other way. That's a great story that the media will come out and cover. An example of that is we did one of these in D.C. It was a very simple Veterans Airlift Command flight. Picked up the phone, called NBC4 in Washington, D.C. and said, hey, we're doing this flight. Have you heard of Veterans Airlift Command? We have a wounded Army soldier who's willing to talk. We'd love to share a program with you. They came out and it ran probably four or five times in the D.C. market. That required really only a phone call, not even a press release. So there's lots of things that I want you guys to get thinking about. And again, our folks here are going to tie a nice neat bow on that. But where you can get the most bang for your buck in terms of public and media relations. Like I kind of mentioned, oftentimes the only investment is a phone call or the time it takes to write a press release. And then social media. I think Eric really hit that home for us, that social media definitely does have a place in flight training and general aviation. And our experts here are going to talk about that a little bit more. So we have with us Dan.
Hello.
McElhatton. Did I get it? All right. Thank you very much. He is with Brand Limited. It's a Las Vegas-based marketing and public relations firm. It specializes in brand management, positioning, and public image management. Dan has 19 years as experience as a graphic designer. He has named golf courses for Arnold Palmer, also a huge fan of aviation, so we like that. He's named restaurants for Wolfgang Puck, designed game packaging for cult movie classics such as Dune and Blade Runner. You haven't heard of Dune.
Dune? Oh, the game?
Ooh. Sorry to admit that.
Ouch.
Blade Runner, yes.
We're in the marketing strategy.
He's a design professor at the College of Southern Nevada, is a father of five, happily married for 8 years, and has been published in over 40 design publications. He's going to provide a great insight for us, especially from someone coming from outside aviation. A lot of times we can get a lot of great, great things from outside our own industry. On the other hand, we have Paula Williams, who is inside our industry, and that's also going to be a great insight. Paula got her marketing start in the finance sector, is that correct? And then moved to aviation, and Paula is a private pilot. So we're going to start working on Dan next.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm going to get out of the way, and I give you Dan McElhatton.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone.
Hang on a second, Dan, I'll get you. It's all you.
Actually,
yeah,
just...
Oh. Where you want?
Where it says the PowerPoint presentation down. Oh.
Right here. I got it.
Actually, right there. Here we go.
Yay!
Here we go. Okay, so yeah, perfect segue. What we were talking about before is like you were trying to figure out how you're going to generate revenue and build up hype and market for yourselves. And PR is such an amazing arm because on one hand, there is a free sector about it. Sometimes it takes a phone call to get into a publication. Sometimes it takes a relationship. So let's talk about that right now, the power of public relations. I mean, the word itself is getting to the public and the word relations. So we're going to have to figure out our relationships that we have in our sector and who we are, and figure out who this is. Literally, if we look at this young child that absolutely loves pilots and stuff like that, his name is Maverick, really. And we actually used him in a photo shoot up in Seattle at a historic aviation museum for a client of ours. But the fact of what I love about Maverick is his passion about planes. He absolutely loves planes. And there's someone in all of us that just loves flight. Loves pilots, loves to fly, wants to be Superman, anything with that. And those are great opportunities for us to think about how we can market ourselves through public relations on those notions. I mean, even in Richard Donner's movie Superman, there was that one moment where, you know, Superman saves the day with the airplane and says, statistically speaking, this is still the safest way to travel. And those type of little moments are absolutely perfect for what you do. And now you have to figure out is how you can build relationships with people, which actually is quite easy. Find out people who are writing articles in newspapers. Find out people who are writing the publications, look at the author, and see if there's ways you can directly contact them and just start a relationship. The basic thing is to do your homework. Research about what are they writing about, and then see how there's any connections and opportunities for yourself so that you can basically ravel in the story with them. It's almost kind of like the common sense of that you meet someone at a backyard barbecue and realize you have something in common. Now, I'm not a pilot. I don't really know much about airplanes other than I get in one, I fly around, and I have a huge fascination for B-52 bomber art. I went to University of Arizona where we had this huge amazing graveyard that I actually got to admire planes from a distance. But ironically, airplanes have been a big part of my life all my life. And the great thing for you is to figure out how we can make a connection for someone like me, or someone that has maybe discretionary income, and say, what would make them want to fly? Is there a pilot inside them? Just like Maverick. Is there a pilot inside him ready to grow up and come to your school, or one day just be an incredible pilot? So the first is basically looking at a simple formula, identify. Then from there, address, and then follow up. So identify, connect. Really, look at names of people writing articles. Don't always just look in local sectors, look in sectors of magazines and articles that you read. Nowadays with social media, more publications are going to a digital format. There's incredible places like ebooks are being downloaded now, and PDFs and podcasts all the time. Look at those formats. If you're not familiar with them, look at iTunes for podcasting and see if there's any relevancy in those markets. Also look at any type of ebooks, and then also look at a site called issue.com, issuu.com. This is an incredible opportunity that if you ever create any material in a PDF format, you can upload it for free. They host it for free, and you can share it across any website or any social media you want, and it turns your PDF book into a flip book. You can even attach a link to it. So basically, it's online distribution and publication for you for free. So I know a lot of you like about free, and we also did a segue where it's like, well, we don't want to undervalue ourselves. That's absolutely true. It's like, you know, Starbucks kind of revolutionized the entire coffee industry when everyone was paying 99 cents at an AM, PM, or a 7-Eleven. All of a sudden, they're educating that $5 coffee is good for you. So now you have to think about, well, how did they do that? Because of the value. They brought something to the table, and that's exactly what you have. The huge safety concerns of flight is absolutely precedent right now. There's crashes that scare people all the time. How are you going to bring value to the table now? That's huge. And those are huge opportunities for you to talk about the value of what you can bring to the table on those safety issues. So again, that's an opportunity. Now, harvesting is planting some seeds. How do you plant some seeds? Well, of course, PR people all the time and journalists get all pitched all the time about everything. Don't worry about a pitch. Do not pitch. People are too transparent these days. Right now, just establish a relationship. And then when you start following and studying journalists, you get to see what they're kind of writing about. You will eventually create content for them, because sometimes they run out of content. Just like a graphic designer might run out of an idea, sometimes we have to just drive around and get inspired by a movie, by a radio song, or something that we downloaded, or just a visual element will sometimes stimulate our creative process. Sometimes journalists hit writer's block. And when they do, they need people like us to come to them to pitch a story or to share with them something that might be relative to what they're writing about. That's key for you. So again, that's a perfect opportunity to harvest. And we're going to talk about more with content with Paula, which would be perfect for you. All right, prepare. Okay, prepare for what? Well, you can't prepare for everything, but you want to build a solid foundation. So what do you want to really prepare about? Well, let's just put it this way. There have been, on average, how many different little accidents that might have been happening in your neighborhood? you hear a little plane landing on a road or something because of emergency problems or a wing falling off or something happening that's crazy. It doesn't happen all the time, but when it does, where are you in that matter? If you're actually the agency, are you prepared for those emergencies? Are you prepared to say statements immediately to the public? Because the public immediately wants an answer. The other good thing is, how can you become the actual expert that the reporters come to about safety issues? So there you have to pitch and provide yourself as the leading authority. I mean, let's put it this way. Most people in this room don't know who Howard Schultz is. So how would we know that he might be the leading authority in coffee? Howard Schultz is the CEO of Starbucks. So we need to think about these things, you know, like the head guy, Steve Jobs, that passed away at Apple. When did he become the head person of MP3 players? When he changed the game. But what about his head designer that actually created the mechanism? So these are things where people go to all the time and ask as experts. You are an expert in many different things. We need to make sure that these journalists and people know about that. Unfortunately, you have to brag about yourself. You had no idea who I was when I came up here on stage. Everyone mispronounced my last name. Thank you for pronouncing it correctly. Appreciate that. But the other thing is, like, when you know a little bit of history of me, like I've named golf courses for Ronald Palmer, and I've named restaurants for Wolfgang Puck, which I actually have, then you go, oh, this guy's done something. That gives you instant credibility. You want to do the same thing. What is going to provide instant credibility for you, period? If some of you have a military background, that's good credibility. But what else? What else do you know? Okay, let's talk about opportunities. I don't know about you, but I love comic books. And what I love about comic books is that it brought an enormous amount of fascination, just like what Maverick is showing at the first slide. But what you're seeing right now, because most of you are here to find a golden egg, something you can use right now, this is current right now on the Batman 3 movie franchise from Christopher Nolan. This is a slide taken right from the movie. The top plane is actually infiltrating the bottom plane, and the bottom plane is going to be the new villain, Bane, who's going to be fighting Batman, who's going to break his back. This movie is going to hit the summer blockbuster like no one's business, and they're going to do this to the plane. What are you going to do to market to the market about this? Is this possible? Is this feasible? What kind of plane is that? How can you relate this to your school? This is current right now. This is coming out in July. You have a whole month or 2 months right now to figure out what you're going to do with these two slides. That's a freebie, guys. Please use it. Say, Christopher Nolan, directing the Batman Rises movie franchise, this is going to be a sequence. How are you going to relate that to you? How are you going to relate that to flight school? How are you going to relate that to what you can use? How are you going to relate that to marketing? Because all over the internet, millions of dollars, not yours, someone else, is going to be marketing this movie. How can you piggyback it? That's another key. Use PR as how you can piggyback items that are currently right now in a whole different genre. You're like, I didn't even think about movies. Well, why not? Tons of movies are using airplanes all the time. But then how you find, now what it's up to you is to find the relation of how, what can you say about this for your business and your school? How can you make that connection? So that's the key, address. How are you going to address the community on those type of items? Corporate. How are you going to address historical notions? Anything historical, facts, anything about flight at all. You know, there's historically, you can even go back into the, from the Wright brothers to currently what's going on right now, to even like drone, any type of thing that deals with aviation and flights, is that you look at those connections, but you look in these categories. These four categories are mostly typical. What is overlooked is current events. What's mostly overlooked is movies. What's overlooked is, you know, I'm sorry, there's a rap song called the G6. And these kids are singing left and right, and they have no idea what the heck a G6 is. You know, my daughter's like, nothing but a G6. I'm like, do you know what that is? It's a plane. Oh. It's a private jet. Oh. That's a huge opportunity, guys. So if you really want to connect, I mean, statistically, anyone can read from a manual. Sometimes that can be rather boring. But sometimes you have to connect on a more relationship level and really connect with the obvious. So here's Maverick in the final shot. Incredible museum. That's a Waco in the background. If you want to know more about the plane, I have the statistical information up here in my folder, but the flight museum is absolutely unbelievable. They have a fully restored P-158 B-series Mustang, and the owner of the facility actually flies it. It's just basically an engine on wings, but The planes are immaculately put together, and the cool thing about it is you can walk in and touch them. Most museums have ropes around them. So again, how are we going to appeal to people, the child inside of us, to be just excited as a little maverick here, or maybe just excited as our pilot here? What legacy are we going to pass on from our flight school to the next? You know, a lot of you probably started the flight school because there was an opportunity for you to seize the market. Some of you are doing it because you think maybe there's some lucrative opportunities for you. Both are true. But now is, what are you going to do with those opportunities? And how are you going to seize it to match not only the younger audience, but the older audience? There was a great question earlier about the Yellow Pages. I come from a different ballpark, and basically to me, Yellow Pages are dead. A younger demographics, the Yellow Pages to them is a stepping stool that they step on to get a cut from the counter. Literally. They don't go to yellowpages.com because as soon as they open their browsers, it's Yahoo and it's Google. Most people are now marketing on Facebook and marketing on Google than any other thing right now. It's crazy. But here's an opportunity is that you can also market on things that no one ever thought about, like Vimeo and YouTube. What do you mean? What can you market? What can you say? Have some fun with some stuff. Maybe just show some mistakes that might happen, or maybe you can show some different interests and put it on the web and then just share it with people. When you share it with the right audience, it's amazing how things can go viral. There's no formula of what makes a video 400 hits to 4 million hits. Really is not. Lately though, in a younger market, as idiotic as it can be and as cheesy as it can be, and almost to the point of irrelevancy and stupidity, usually flies through the internet like gangbusters. It's hysterical. But when you do something really methodic and educational, it's like, to a younger market. Now to an older market, that's exactly what they're looking for. So again, notice the target market that you're hitting, and that's what you want to do with approaching with a video. And nowadays, you don't have to have a heavy camera and a major director, you can use your phones. You know, with flips and simple gobos and stuff like that, you can do simple flat right on the mark, you know, right on the money right now. I can do a video of me talking to you, post up on YouTube. It happens literally that quick. So there's another shot of the museum showing the beautiful Waco aircraft. The Mustangs that they fly. I just love the graphics on these. Just have such a beautiful fascination with them. All right, follow up, the big key. How many people in this room know Delford Smith? Yay, nice, one hand. Good deal, okay. I never knew about Delford Smith until someone that I've kind of learned under, his name's Tom, was mentored by Delford Smith. Delford Smith actually owned Evergreen Aviation before he passed away and put it onto his family. But Evergreen Aviation has an amazing, impeccable rule. One thing that Delford Smith would always do is he would know the statistics of everything about his planes, his hangars, everything, down to the wire, where he never looked at his computer or anything. He had it in the top of his head. So he was an analytic person that was just unbelievable. But one thing about Delford Smith is that everything in his garages and everything in his aviation facilities were so immaculately placed. Everything had its proper place. You can eat off the floors. He wanted it so immaculate that he was prepared for anything so that there was no loss of time. He hated a waste of time. And that's something that you have to think about too, is what can you apply to yourself so you don't have a waste of time? Because if you're prepared for certain opportunities, you're ready to go. What if a magazine right now needs an article, what do you have? And they call you up. Because if you're established a relationship with a journalist, how are you prepared? Hopefully we can go over a little bit more about content with Paula, because you need to prepare yourself for those opportunities. So when I'm talking about the Delford Smith approach, is how do you have, or what do you have in your wings right now, at least 5 or 6 stories that you could share with the world? And if you don't know, then get in relationship with the people that you work with. Get in relationship with the pilots and get in relationship with some of the students or whatever, and utilize it and leverage it immediately. Like the first thing you get back, have that ready in the can. Just have some conversations with them and be prepared for it. The second thing is what I call the pilot checklist. You know, we all know about these things, is that a pilot always does a checklist before takeoff. Well, what checklist do you have for your PR and marketing right now? Some of you are going, well, do I spend money? And that's not a checklist. That's just a question. A checklist is, what are you going to do? What do you really want to market? Is there a certain kind of school you want to market? Is there a certain kind of plane you want to market? Is there a certain kind of element you want to market? And then you have to figure out two things, is who are you going to market to? The funny thing is, most people will market in the same type of magazines that they read rather than what their customers might be reading. For instance, my customers are not reading Times and Newsweek. They're reading Barron's and Wall Street. So you got to think about maybe where your investors are at right now. Are they reading what you're reading? You know, I read Fast Company. Most people don't even know that magazine. But digitally, where might be your investor or potential person with discretionary income? What are they reading? Are they reading Seth Godin's Godin, G-O-D-I-N, I always mispronounce his last name, his blog, or Tim Ferriss's? You know, they have millions of followers, and they talk about bringing simple knowledge to the people. They're making complex situations very simple. You know, Tim Ferriss wrote The 4-Hour Work Week. These type of things is where maybe people with discretionary income are going because they want to simplify their lives. They want to simplify their money. They want to make better investments. Sound kind of like your customers, maybe? Those are things to think about. Now, how are you going to address them? Keep them connected. How are you going to connect them with the stories that you have? Just get in a relationship with some of these people and look at what they're doing. Sometimes maybe even talk about them. Use Facebook not to pitch, but to connect. Use LinkedIn to pitch. Use Google to pitch. Use Facebook to just say, hi, how you doing? Hey, let's get together. Use Facebook to post something up kind of funny, or something that's somewhat relative that could be taken as a slight pitch, but maybe in a more humorous way. Prepare your questions. Prepare questions that you want to ask them. What are some things that some of these journalists want to write about? What are some of the things they're passionate about? Because when you get in a relationship with them, it'll help you. When we did a press release for Altrian, we just released it through PR Newswire, and went to New York City. And basically, from once it was pitched into New York City and released, this is just a single press release, it basically, from one piece of paper, cost a few hundred dollars to just put it out in the Newswire, actually transacted in $10,000 in sales for our company. $10,000. That means people came to Altrian.com, looked at the product, and bought the product. That was a wise investment. And that's what you want to think about. With everything changing in the marketplace, there's questions, how do I differentiate myself? That one's very simple. You are you, and you are different. So sell you. Do not do what everyone else is doing. Everyone else has probably got the same routine as you. And you might have one little thing that's different. The biggest difference is who you are, and what do you bring to the table? That's key. Just remember, it's a process, it's not a project. Don't expect instant gratification. Don't expect as soon as you put the PR rider, like, not gonna happen. You know, the biggest thing I hear from all my clients is like, oh, I spent $2,000 or $5,000 a month on some press releases. I haven't seen squat. Really. Most public relations are really in bed, if you will, in relationships with every single journalist that they know. They're constantly looking for opportunities, and they're constantly pitching you in different ways and categories to get you notified. The funny thing is that maybe the first 4 months there's nothing, but then all of a sudden you're on a front cover somewhere. You know how hard it is to get on a front cover? You know how hard it is to get inside an article and get a full spread for free? Most magazines charge you $6,000 for an ad, sometimes $3,000 for a full page ad. Imagine a full page on an article on you. My wife, who wrote a book, I was pitching an editor locally, and they said, oh, by the way, our deadline already passed. We don't have anything available. I said, great. When something comes up, we're ready for you, and anything you need, we're here to help you out. 2 days later, by the way, one of our advertisers dropped out. We have a spread. Do you still have that thing on your wife? Yes. Be prepared. Bam. My wife got a 2-page spread for free. Okay. Now, that's just books, but that can relate to you. And that's it. Hopefully that'll help you.
I'm going to try and leave some time at the end for questions because I know you'll have more for Dan and Katie as well as myself. And I know this is a fascinating field and it's much more interesting than anything else we're going to be doing. So, but one of the key things I want to start with is that sign out there that you saw on your way in here that pilots are people, customers are people too. And building relationships takes time, just like Dan said, you can't expect instant relationships or instant gratification from sales, marketing, PR, any of these types of things. They're all based on people getting to know each other and learning more about each other. And if there are three words I want you to remember when you go home, it's tell good stories. All the rest of the stuff that we've been talking about is about channels, containers for those stories. Facebook is a container, your website is a container, you have a, hopefully, a newsletter at your place That's just a container. Nobody would read this unless it had good stories and useful information in there. Same thing with your website, same thing with your Facebook page, same thing with your Twitter account, same thing with pretty much any publication that you put out. And as a flight school, we're dealing in publications. We're all publishing companies. That's what we do, is we communicate information, we disseminate knowledge. So, you know, we put out, we put our textbooks in the hands of people. We also need to extend that education and that relationship and that process into our marketing. So there shouldn't be a hard line between, you know, here's sales over here, and here's instruction over here. We put a lot of instruction in our marketing and a lot of marketing in our instruction. So, or at least we advise our clients to do that. We're actually a marketing company that works with several flight schools and related types of companies. I'm going to show you a couple of examples of marketing that we do for flight schools. And what this is stories. This is on Aerostar's blog. And I know FIT, you're here as well. This is a story that you guys are doing together. For the first time, aviation students will be able to earn credit hours toward graduation while getting a type rating in an A320 or a B737. It's a great story, and it's got two great students in it, you know, and everybody loves those faces and loves those success stories. So that's one of them. Another one of them, if we can go to the next one. This one is a story from a particular student, Kenyon Jabbar, who is a graduate of Aerostar, who got a job with a regional airline. Now, the big question on everybody's mind, if they're considering flight training as a career, is, will you get me a job after I graduate? And, you know, as a flight school, we can never guarantee that. But the best proof that we can offer is stories, good stories from real people who have been there and done that and got a good result. And so here we illustrate the story of, you know, the old model used to be that you'd get your private, you would become an instructor so that you could build time, you know, all of those things until you're able to take, you know, the least paying, lowest paying pilot jobs until you're able to qualify for an airline job. That was the old model. The new model is you get your private, multi-engine instrument, type rating, go to work immediately for a foreign airline, work there for a couple of years, come back, and then apply for one of the majors in the U.S. if that's your goal. So, you know, which one of those earned you more money in that two-year interim? We can tell that story through the eyes of a student, and, you know, that's 1,000 times more effective than any other way of getting that across, because we're all human beings. We love stories about other human beings. So, you know, tables and you know, manuals and statistics and all that stuff is fantastic. But when it comes down to it, what really gets people's attention is stories. There's one more up here that I'd like to show you. At the beginning, Rob was talking about passion. And I wanted to give you this story. This is Laura Kaufman. Laura Kaufman at the Greenville Downtown Airport. What she did is she became involved because she's got two little boys that love airplanes. She's not a pilot. She's not even in the airline industry or aviation industry at all. She's got two little boys that love airplanes. At her old home in Atlanta, she was able to, they had a playground where she could take her boys and they could play on the playground and watch the airplanes and get up close and personal and all those things. And then she moved to Greenville. There was no access to the airport. There's, you know, the big barbed wire fence. She couldn't get anywhere near them with her little boys to let them watch airplanes land and take off and watch the tugs and all those other cool things that happen at the airport. So what she did is she contacted all of the airports in the area and said, you know, do you have a restaurant? Do you have a playground? Do you have any public access to the airport that will let us get up close and personal with these things? And I'm spending a lot. How do I get my boys involved with your airport? And they came back to her and said, well, you know, we don't have any of those things, but we want them. What if you open a restaurant? And she said, well, you know what? I am a stay-at-home mom with two boys, and I'm not going to do that. But why don't you hire me to find somebody to put in a restaurant? And she became Greenville Downtown Airport's first public relations director.
Can you scroll up on that article and show the picture? She convinced a restaurant to open on the airport property. They complied with all the regulations. They got, went to city council meetings, got everything approved and confirmed and everything else. And now you can see there are tables out there with just a little bitty fence right out there on the apron. And those are the kinds of people, and those are the kinds of stories, and that's the kind of passion. And you guys all have a little pad in front of you like this. You should have 10 stories like this. You've been dealing with people for years in your flight school. There are stories like the girl with type 2 diabetes who ended up flying, quite a bit, and that changed her life. There's the kid with autism that ended up flying, and it changed his life quite a bit. You've got a million stories. You should be writing those down, and we can always talk about techniques, and we can talk about SEO, and we can talk about, should I use Twitter or Facebook or whatever. But once you have those stories, you can chop those up into bite-sized pieces, 144 characters, and stick it on Twitter and put a link to this article. You can put the picture on Facebook and say, learn how this woman changed the lives of a lot of people in Greenville, North Carolina. South Carolina, I'm sorry. I got carried away. So, this is all really good stuff, but it all starts with stories. So I'm going to start our presentation and see if this works. I just wanted to give that to you because it was, you guys are a lot further along than I had thought. Given the last couple of, like you said, there was a really good segue to a lot of these things. So a lot of the stuff I'm going to skip over. How many people in here, your primary role is sales and marketing? Okay. By the end of this presentation, I think everyone's hand will be in the air. Nothing happens until somebody sells something, right? Your airplanes stay on the apron. There is nothing that happens. Your flight instructors are all sitting around either cleaning something or sitting on the couch or, on Facebook, which is fine because they're at least promoting your company if they're doing it right. So why is sales so hard? We're already bombarded with ads. We're busy. We forget what we've seen and read. And there's a ton of competition for our time, attention, and money. We've talked about this already a little bit, about who is your competition, really. Let's start with your career pilots. You're competing with traditional universities, right? Some people, their parents, their guidance counselors, everybody else is saying, oh, don't be a pilot. That's a horrible career. Go do this instead. You're competing with entry-level jobs. You are competing with the military. And the military has got a fantastic marketing system. And that's one that's scanning for the same demographics that you are. And that's a really great one to study, is the military. And they do the same thing. They publish great stories about people who change their lives by joining the military and so forth. If you are a recreational organization, and that's your intention with, or most of your pilots are recreational pilots, you're competing with the country club, you're competing with the yacht club, you're competing with the ski resorts, you're competing with golfing, the other things that people are spending about a similar amount of money on. You need to look at the marketing campaigns and the PR that these folks have. We've also got Harley Davidson. Now that's another really great one to study as a flight school because they are gunning for the same demographic that you are. And they are spending a lot more money, probably, than most of us are able to spend. But we can look for the things that they do, and we can emulate those and tie in with them as we talked about. So you can target the right buyers, you can be useful, and you can be memorable. We've already talked about this quite a bit. Follow-up is essential. And we recommend that our clients spend 50% of their marketing budget on advertising and 50% on follow-up. And the reason for that is because you can do things like the AeroCamp, and they work very well, especially if it's a prepackaged system that's already been proven somewhere else. That's fantastic. the question is, what do you do with them once they get in the door? And you covered this 1,000 times better than I will, so I'm not going to even go there with marketing, or I'm sorry, with the branding. Taglines and theme lines, we touched on this a little bit, but what is different about your flight school, and can you sum it up in a sentence? Okay, you're not the lowest cost provider on the field, maybe you are the most convenient provider on the field. Maybe you take people's dry cleaning to the cleaners while they're having a lesson. You know, I mean, there's a million things that you could do to be the high-end provider, the high service provider, the business details provider, you know, making sure that people get to their meetings on time with everything the way they want it. There's a lot of things that you could do that you could summarize in a sentence and that will really do a lot of good. Now we could spend an entire session on this map here, but we're not going to. Marketing, one of the ways of looking at it, and Eric covered this quite well, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. Phase one, getting attention. Phase two, credibility and conversion. And phase three, resales, recaptures, and referrals. The two most ignored segments are this one, phase two, and phase three. The linchpin to a lot of the marketing that we do is this piece right here in phase two, and that's the capture that Eric talked about. Putting something behind a form. You know, some of those great stories, or one of our clients, which is Aerostar, put together an ebook, 5 tough questions you should ask before investing in advanced flight training. And this is something that people can download. It's a pretty substantial ebook. It's about 20 pages. If you go to their website, you can fill out a form and you can get it and see what's in there. But it answers a lot of their questions, and a lot of their students are foreign. A lot of their students are coming from far away, and their parents want to know, where am I sending my kid? You know, what are the hotels like? What is the food like? You know, what are the requirements? What are the visa requirements? You know, is he going to have any, is it large classes or small? You know, what are the simulators like? How much simulator time do you get? Can you save a session from your simulator, take it home and put it on your computer and run through that selection on something that maybe you're having trouble with? So that that ebook right there feeds into that credibility and conversion section, which leads to your sale. After your sale, you're not done. You know, this is just like flight training. My flight instructor always said, always be thinking about the next step. You know, and I'm sure as a flight instructor, you've had the experience of you're taking off with somebody new, and they are so excited that they got the wheels off the ground that they completely lose it, you know. And you're like, okay, we're not done. We still have things to do. So your sale is like takeoff. That is when you're just getting started. You know, you still have radio calls to do, you still have to get to your VY, you still have to make your navigations, you still have to do all those things. In marketing, you still have to have a resell, recapture, referral program, you know, that helps that student stay engaged. You have to resell them on coming to class, you have to resell them on doing their homework, you have to resell them on getting, you know, all of the reasons they started this thing, because there's a million other things competing for their time and money. All right, and you talked about the marketing plan. How much time do we have left, Kate? Eric, you talked about the marketing funnel. I've got 2 of them that I want to show you. This is your typical flight school model. 90% of your marketing money is in phase one. And this is the model that we recommend. 50% of your marketing is in phase one. Why do we do that? I'm going to show you 2 examples of 2 flight schools, one of which is using the first model and one of which is using the second. But first, we're going to talk about you know, content, builds relationships, which builds sales. We've already talked about that, so we're going to skip that one. Great content that your prospects value. We had talked about tutorials, funny things that happen. You know, people just, you know, love jokes and pictures and things. Stories of individual people. That is my charming husband and his charming airplane. This is a. You know, articles, movies, you know, these can take many different forms. And, you know, like Dan was saying, everybody's got a cell phone. So you could create 5 stories before you leave this building of people that you met and, you know, things that are relevant to your flight school, things that you may want to do differently. So what you're doing is you're creating a network of stakeholders, which includes reporters. One of these pieces of paper that you have in front of you, you may want to be making a list of stakeholders and local reporters, you know, people that you see in your newspaper all the time. What do they write about? You know, are they on LinkedIn? Are they on Facebook? Connect with them. Start building a relationship now. Find out what they need. They're overworked and underpaid the same as the rest of us, so if you can find ways to make their job easier, that really helps them out. So this is how two different people do this. We're going to call this Random Ray's Flight School. Now, Random Ray does things pretty much like most flight schools. He does things basically depending on, you know, he runs out of students and he panics, basically. He realizes that, oh my goodness, I have no incoming students this quarter. I've got a lot of students graduating and I'm going to have a lot of empty airplanes and a lot of unbusy instructors. So he does something like when the radio station calls and says, you know, we could do a live remote at your location for a couple $1,000, and Random Ray jumps on that and says, this is great, let's do this. And so he fries up some hamburgers and, you know, has a fabulous event. Or he uses Groupon, which is another one of those providers that will bring a lot of people in the door, basically because he saw an ad for Groupon and it sounded like a great idea. So not that Groupon or the radio remotes are particularly bad, it's just that any marketing activity that is done as a random act of marketing is a very bad thing. If you haven't thought through what you're going to do with all these people, and you haven't thought through the next step and the next step and the next step in your marketing process, these things can do more harm than good. So he has, you know, hundreds of people come through the door, eat his hamburgers, track stuff all over his carpeting, you know, get his airplanes all sticky, and, you know, all of those things. And out of that, he doesn't really have a process to capture those people. His instructors kind of wander around. This is not actually Random Ray's Flight School. This is a different picture. But for illustration, his instructors are kind of milling around in this giant blob of people going, hi there, my name is, you know, Bob, the flight instructor, and I, you know, we'd really love to have you join our school. But there really isn't a script, there isn't a plan, there isn't a capture mechanism to get those people's names. So some people will come up to their flight instructors and say, you know, ask questions and things. So they do capture a few leads, but most of them are pretty random. So you can see the downside of Random Ray's approach. Feast or famine, lots of unqualified leads, and no money for follow-up or referral programs. He just spent that $2,000 on that live remote, and he's out of money for the quarter. Random Ray is kind of stuck. He's got a few names, and he will call them back in a haphazard sort of manner, and some of them may sign up, and some of them may not. But not altogether a successful experience. If you follow a slightly different model, where you put 50% of your marketing money in phase one, and then the other 50% between phase two and phase three, depending on the circumstances, you can do some different things. So now we have Systematic Sam. These are fake names, you can probably But Systematic Sam has that ebook that people are downloading, and he directs everybody to that, either through Facebook, through Twitter, through his blog, and so forth and so on. That's kind of his capture mechanism. He also captures people that walk in the door, and has them fill out a form for a contest or for a newsletter or something along those lines. And based on that, he's building a house list, and he's trying to get that number as large as he possibly can. Now, once somebody's on that house list, and that house list includes not only prospective clients, but also his current students and their families, it also includes reporters, it also includes the city council, it also includes the airport board, it also includes anybody else who is going to impact Systematic Sam's life in a good or bad way, because he wants to tell his side of the story, his way, to these people. And then from that point, and you can't see it terribly well, but he does a number of things, one of which is a printed newsletter. This could be daily, weekly, quarterly, whatever, depending on the demographics of your list. He does weekly emails. He does blog postings, you know, with subscriptions, and other kinds of things to keep these people in the loop and to keep telling those stories to these folks. After the sale, then, of course, he's got a referral program. He's got a loyalty program. He's got, you know, Bring a Friend Day, you know, other kinds of things, because he's still got, you know, 25% of his money left over potentially in this phase three. and he can afford to do some of those things. And referred students are the very best on the planet. I don't know if you've ever had any experience with referred students, but they already know what they're getting into. They already have a positive feeling about your school because they know somebody who's been there. They have a social connection. They're likely to stay longer and spend more money. Okay, so yeah, we talked about that. We talked about the different containers that you can use. Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter. I highly recommend Facebook for everyone. How many folks here are focused on recreational pilots? And the rest of you are career? Career, okay, how about mix? Okay, almost everybody's a mix. You have an interesting challenge because you have to speak very specifically to people who come from a very different mindset. Your career people are wanting efficiency and they're wanting safety and they're wanting career options. And your recreational people are a completely different mindset. So we have had situations where we've advised flight schools to make two entirely different presences on Facebook, two entirely different blogs and so forth. They can lead him to the same website, but you know, honestly, you're trying to serve two very different constituencies with the same stuff. And to really feel like you're hitting them right here where it counts, you really have to target that more specifically. So, you know, and you can do that in a phased sort of way. I mean, there's lots of ways you can do that. But we can talk about that more at the break if anybody has any questions or anything like that. We're going to be sticking around for lunch, I think, unless there's anything like that. Referral programs. A couple of ideas for referral programs. You can, again, you know, if you have a newsletter, if you have a Facebook page, if you have any of those things, you can run contests for referrals using those media. And it's just like Dan was saying, if you're ready for anything, if you've got a blog set up, if you've got a Facebook page with a good following, if you've got a Twitter page with a good following, you've got a pretty flexible base from which you can run like a referral campaign where you ask students to bring in another student to a hangar chat or something like that. They get a, you know, just for bringing them in the door, they should get something. Either, you know, some kind of recognition or some kind of benefit. And, you know, it's usually best to make those public so you can say, you know, this person brought that person and so they both get t-shirts. You know, however you want to do that, you know, those can be really helpful programs. Also for the career-minded kids, you can always throw in something like a resume service, you know, something that's completely unrelated to your school. You can make a deal with a different organization. Where you do interview prep or you know, add value in some way and make that contingent on, you know, bring someone in or at least give us three names of people that you think would be interested and our folks will talk to them. And based on that, we'll provide something, some benefit to you because those referred students are sometimes 50% of your business or more. You're right. So, and anyway. So 6 steps to sales success, and I know this has been a little bit disjointed because we wanted to accommodate what had been said before without restating anything, but 6 steps to sales success, coordinate your efforts into a system, make sure you always have the next step figured out for every client or every prospect. Don't ever get off the phone with somebody without saying, so when are we going to talk again? Next week, next month, you know, next year? Whatever is appropriate, or you know, if they say don't call me again, then at least there's one that you can cross off your list. But never get off the phone with somebody without that next step. Never get off email with somebody without getting off that next step. Here's the information you provided. You know, let's talk again next week. You know, always leave that next step available. Spend 50% of your marketing budget on phases 2 and 3. Be at the right place at the right time, and I think Eric and Dan addressed that really well. Be useful. Those tutorials and other kinds of information, if you can be generous with information, that really helps a lot. Be memorable. It's a lot better than being boring, right? You know, boring press releases never get published. And that's why you have to write great stories, or tell great stories. That's really what we're here for. And have an outstanding tagline or elevator speech and use it everywhere. every time you send a press release, every time you do a tweet, a Facebook post, anything like that, use your tagline or your elevator speech. And that is all I had, except that there's a couple of things that you've got on a handout in front of you. One is an ebook, and the other is our newsletter. And you can send it for those if you like. So that's my next step. I'm practicing what I preach.
I have a question, or I have a comment about Groupon.
Okay.
I was working as a flight instructor at a flight school which used this Groupon for marketing. And from my perspective as a flight instructor who had to fly these people around, it was awful.
Yeah.
And the reason it was awful is because nearly every single person who I put in the plane next to me really didn't have any interest except to go on a pretty airplane ride. And as a result, I was spending 2 to 3 hours of my time giving somebody a tour of the airplane, tour of the local area, and I made no money. So since I have to run myself as a personal business, if you will, I found, as soon as I saw my scheduled Groupons, I found reasons to not do that work. And I started looking at the number of Groupons that the company was essentially scheduling. It was about 40% of the total flight activity. Then I started asking questions like, well, how many of these people come back? Well, I don't know. So I would just be hesitant to go down that route by just randomly offering Groupons or free discounts, if you will, for flying with no real target of why you're doing it. Because my real world experience is not good.
Hey, can I ask you a question?
I can tell you, I did preface it by my financial incentive for doing this. So for example, at this school, you essentially were paid a fixed price for flying a Groupon flight. So when you looked at this fixed dollar amount you got for the Groupon flight and you turned it into an hourly rate, it'd be better to go work at McDonald's.
Okay.
So if you're going to have an employee who's going to exercise that marketing aspect for you, you need to be able to compensate the employee regardless of what type of activity that employee is doing. So from my perspective, as being a flight instructor, it did not work at all. Now, whether it worked at the school level, I have no idea. All I know is I didn't get any real good answers, and I didn't want to spend, you know, 9 hours of my day, you know, not earning enough money to cover the gas it cost me to go to work.
Well, you didn't get permanent students.
Yeah.
Very good comments.
I would like to say something to that, because we've been very successful with Groupon. We've probably sold over 2,000 of them. And I tell my instructors, you've got 2,000 leads walking in the door. You have to work with me as a marketing person, sell my business, sell the airplanes, and sell the flight lessons. The flight instructor has to be in total mesh with the business, because he also has to help you market. If the flight instructor is getting frustrated, he's not getting paid, I agree with that. But on the flip side, where else do you generate 2,000 leads that come in your door? It has to work together.
Well, it sounds like, too, we're having an educational process, which is really good. First is what is being said in the Groupon, what's being said as the offer, and second is how is the conversion rate occurring. So we have, which is a good learning lesson here, which we can learn from, but then now we have positive lessons, so hopefully you can share from information from them to maybe transform that into a positive. Because the bottom line with that, building a database from Groupon alone in the email structure is huge. You know, that's a database you can pull from. Now, there may have been tons of people on these flights that had, you know, they're going around for the nice little tour, but we never know how many of those people on the tour actually have people who are genuinely interested in flights and what was sold to them, and then figure out how we can do the follow-up with that piece.
Yeah, I would just say, you know, Groupon is not good or bad, just like Facebook is not good or bad. You know, there is no channel in particular that is evil in terms of advertising or anything else. Random acts of marketing are evil. You know, they'll take your money, they'll give you a bunch of stuff that you don't have a plan to attack. They cause more trouble than they're worth. So if you use Groupon as a random act of marketing, it's going to bite you. But if you've thought through your next step and your next step and your next step and you've used it as part of the system, then sure, Groupon can be just as good as anything else.
Yeah, actually, on top of what you guys said, we are actually selling an airplane through Groupon. I mean, this guy came in for Discover Flight. He never knew about aviation, nothing like that.
Uh-huh.
Never heard our airport existed either. And he came out and started looking at calls and found out how affordable it is. And he's actually going to buy an airplane. And I pay my instructor for a full rate of what they're supposed to get paid. On top of that, if they sign up, they get incentives, they get bonuses. And also, if they sell airplanes, they get their share. So it's a big incentive.
One more question or comment? Does anybody have
anything? I have one question. You say Groupon is a random act of marketing, but if you really look at it, it's probably one of the best things out there for flight schools, because I agree. I mean, not a lot of people knew that my airport existed.
Right.
2,000 people didn't know, hey, I can actually come. I look at it this way. Right now, there's, if you take Groupon, travel to whatever you want, and you look at this, I look at it this way. There's more people out there that always wanted to try it.
Yeah.
Than always wanted to get their lesson. And that's what I sell. I say, look, you know what? You want to come in and try it? Great. That's what we're here for. We'll put you in a simulator for 30 minutes. I'm very blessed. I have San Francisco.
Yeah.
I'm Golden Gate. I'm Alcatraz. So we take them over that. And they come back. And then what we try to do on the phone here is say, hey, you know what? If you want to bring a friend along, It's an extra $50. They'll take all the pictures for you, and we'll post them up on Facebook or something for you.
See, you've turned Groupon into part of your system.
Right.
It's not a random act of marketing.
We also do a fill out an application with their email, phone number, and then we do a follow-up call.
Exactly. You are doing a fabulous job of integrating Groupon, which is a single element, into a system. So Groupon isn't good or bad in and of itself, just like radio remotes aren't good or bad, or anything else. It's just, are you planning for that, and are you including it in a system that includes a phase two and a phase three? If you are, fantastic. You know, it may be the best thing out there. for the particular demographic you're going after. But just randomly doing it without thinking it through has caused people issues when they get into trouble. But it sounds like you did it right, so congratulations, that's cool.
Yeah, and just real quick, like, just reiterate, you know, in marketing in general, there's so many different avenues, and now with the technology and everything that's available to you as the corporations to market yourself, the incredible thing about social networking is the most effective thing in advertising used to be direct mail. Because direct mail is like you had a list, you sent out that list, you followed up with a list, and you can see a conversion by whoever brought back something. If you put up a billboard, you can't really tell who's coming in by the billboard or not. If you put an ad in a magazine, you really can't follow up unless you have a special code. So direct mail is one of the old, you know, traditional forms of marketing that you really could rate. And then now with SEO optimization and Facebook and loud mics, there's ways that you can track people instantly. And the great thing about like Groupon or anything that's online is that there's usually a name and email behind it or a URL that can be trackable, and it's something that you can build into a database. That way, your investment is not only just for the advertising, but the continuation of the marketing. And how are you going to use that pool of inventory to you to keep remarketing yourselves? It's huge and it's very invaluable. Now with like Google Analytics and with things that you can get from Facebook, you can track on the fly how many people are coming to your site, how many people are clicking on a coupon. It's hysterical. I mean, it's almost like overdose of, I call it paralysis by analysis. You can just like literally just go numb by all the statistics that you can get. But the beautiful thing is you can track now every single dollar you spend. Where before, some things were more esoteric, you know. Oh, we're gonna do a commercial for you. Oh, great, we're gonna run it on the air, it's gonna hit this demographic. So, oh, what's our rate of return? I can't tell you, it's a secret. Now that's usually how ad agencies work. It's like they just say, this is our secret ingredient, it works. Now, one of our clients is Altran. They made over $10 million in profits using direct mail and online marketing. $10 million profit because it's trackable. And it's true. And you know, you can dress up anything in a great brand, which is really solid and does help, yes. But things like newsletters and blogs are trackable. Online marketing is trackable. You want to have that. You want to look at those analytics. And then, like what you're saying, is balancing it out with systems. Those are huge key indicators, especially with follow-up. When the Groupon's over with, how about all the people that did show up? Just a friendly little reminder. You know, because that's a database you can tap into. Now, and you can even just enroll them into another process and see how that works for you as well. Those are key indicators of opportunities that are just sitting for you, literally collecting dust, which could be more money to your bottom line.
I feel like my job here today was very easy. These guys handled it perfectly, professionally. Thank you for having us. We're right on time for lunch, and I'm sure they'd love to take any questions you guys have after.